are, some of them are a little bit more touch and go. So I appreciate that you got everything under control.
You will.
So I'll grab an XLR, send Augustine back in down here.
Yep.
I'm going to go set up the overflow. Thanks, bud. Oh, yeah. No, we're only 5 minutes late. It's not bad. Okay. So.
Check 1, 2, 1, 2. Check 1, 2, 1, 2. Check 1, 2. Check 1, 2. Thank you.
Slimline.
Slimline.
Yeah, I go around the outside.
Check one. Check one. Check. Check. One. Check. One. Two. Three. One. Check. One. Two. Check. Mic 6 inches. One. Check. Check. Hello. Check. 3, 4. Six. Check. Good. Down. Up.
Check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6, 6. Check 1, 2.
Thank you.
shift it a little bit that way? Snowden?
Oh, you're good.
Okay.
You're good. You're perfect.
But I have a question. When I introduce...
You're going through a microphone?
Ed, you're still with me?
I am, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's over 900 people watching on live already.
I'm good over there. Sounded a little bit bassy, but it's a feed. It's a web feed. I don't care what you mean. So we're okay over there. Do we have a short network cable? There's not one in the room. Oh, you're okay with the slim line? You're good?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to go next door and... How else do you know how we're going to proceed? Are we going to let everybody in here first and then come back to the other room?
Check 1, 2, 2. Check 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Very good. Your audio is good there. Good. Check 1, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2. Check 1, 2. Oh, these guys should be off. These? Oh, okay. So which ones are you saying? The fluorescents up here? The squares?
Presentation is done. Jamie can put the lights back on.
Yeah,
just for his official part, kill the lights because you're not going to be filming. It's going to be full VGA there anyway. Hey, you're fast. Thank you. Okay, Jamie, I'm going to. You don't have a TV cell on you, right? You don't have a TV cell on you? I was trying to text you. So.
Everything you're saying. Thank you, Ed.
Is going to sell it to him, right? Okay, so I'm going to go next door.
Sorry?
Okay, so I have a question.
Yes.
Oh, there you go. You answered. There. I'm just sorry for asking again. Yep.
Boy Stewart.
What?
Talk to security. Okay, well, yeah, she should be able to come in. She's media. Augustin. I don't know. I'm not sure. Text me later. I don't have Jamie's cell, so I'll text you if there's anything and talk to Jamie if there's anything. Okay, I'm going to go into the overflow room. That's already running. But I'm going to put this there. And if everything's going good, once you start, all right, leave me the card. Leave the card with Jamie. Yeah. I'm on Rogers with my phone. Jamie, I'm going to bookmark the link on the browser, okay? So if you talk about that room in case you need the link for it, I'm going to bookmark it in Firefox. Okay, I'm going to bookmark it. It'll be right in the bookmark. So if it's Firefox I'm using or streaming from, so I'll bookmark it so you'll see YouTube video. But it'll be fine.
No, I know, it's weird. That's like I said. When I checked, there were over 900 people viewing live on it. Thank you.
This is streaming back to Snowden. Also, this already took me through.
Do you need another webcam?
Ed, just to let you know, we're going to start in about 15 minutes.
Roger that. Thank you.
Thank you. I was watching the live stream and I was like, that's Colin.
Yeah.
Hey.
I'm moderating the questions.
Yeah. Is there going to be like a Q&A section? Or
yes,
is it...
there is. I hope it doesn't get cut short because everything started so late.
Yes.
Due to the problem of getting everyone inside.
Yeah. So. That's incredible. This is so cool. I recently saw his interview with John Oliver.
Oh, right.
You see where he went to Russia and like later they were right across from the Kremlin. I thought that was really interesting.
It's amazing to see.
I almost didn't make it in because I had a class in here until 6.
Right.
And then after that, they kicked us all out.
Right.
And by that time, the line was thousands of people long.
I was
like, ugh.
Well, you were lucky that you had a class in here.
Yeah, yeah.
And now,
so there I go.
Everyone was like screaming.
What is... And there's, so like, most of the chairs are going to be filled with, like, professors and stuff. Okay. And they're live streaming it?
Yeah, they are.
I thought there was, like, no recording allowed.
Yeah, you know, we just talked to them. How many thousands of people there were.
Okay, nice.
That was nice.
There you go.
Yeah.
Cool, you just, like, talked to Edward Snowden, no big deal.
Well, I actually...
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Exactly.
Oh.
Yeah,
that's
well,
amazing.
Enjoy.
Yes, of course. Thank you so much for getting this done.
Thank you. Hello. So it's just to inform you that Leacock, the other room is also being filled right now. So we will start in 10 minutes. So thank you for your patience. Okay. Okay. So we're going to start. Okay. So bonsoir à tous. So thank you for being here. We sort of underestimated how many people would be interested. At the beginning, we thought, well, will we fill this room? So we've. So I guess that Snowden is important for you. And I think in light of what's happening also right now in Quebec and journalism, it makes it, the coincidence is quite good. So my name is Christine Ross, and I'm the director of Media at McGill. Media at McGill is a hub of interdisciplinary research, scholarship, and public outreach on issues of media, technology, and culture. And for us, it's really interesting to bring Edward Snowden tonight because in light of what we've done in the last years, and especially I want to refer, perhaps some of you have seen the conference given by Glenn Greenwald on October 2014. So when Glenn Greenwald is a journalist who initially met with Edward Snowden in the now famous hotel, the Mira Hotel in Hong Kong, a hotel made famous by Laura Poitras' Citizen Four, and who broke the story on American and British global surveillance programs in a series of articles published by The Guardian in 2013. A series based on classified documents from the National Security Agency, NSA, disclosed by Edward Snowden. So we're really very happy to be able to secure a follow-up to that lecture. And so we thank the Beaverbrook Canadian Foundation, as well as McGill University, for making this event possible. I also want to thank Sophie Toupin, Media at McGill's project administrator, for looking into the huge number of details implied in the organization of this event. So the person who's going to be hosting this event tonight is one of my colleagues. Her name is Biela Coleman, Professor Biela Coleman. She holds the Wolf Chair in Scientific and Technological Literacy here at McGill. And so she writes, she researches, she teaches on questions of hacking, whistleblowing, anonymous, hoaxing, and even the aesthetics of hacking. And so she will be, she's a professor in the Department of Art History and Communication Studies and also Anthropology. And so she will be presenting Snowden because she is our expert on these questions. And just for you to know, she will present Snowden, and then we'll have his presentation will last about 50 minutes, and then there'll be a Q&A, a period of 30 minutes. So we ask that you please put your mobile phones on silent mode, and due to restrictions, well, no, the live streams is now possible. My God, yeah. So so now Biela will introduce Edward Snowden.
Right. I think to start first, I'm going to just say how incredibly exciting it is that so many students are here to watch Snowden, to hear about these issues. We were really blown away when we put up the Facebook page, and within a week, there was 5,000 RSVPs. So clearly, in many ways, Snowden needs no introduction. And that's because in 2013, he really shook the world when he became one of the most significant and famous whistleblowers of recent times because he revealed numerous secret government surveillance programs with huge implications related to democracy and journalism. But let me introduce him in light of a major news story that has shocked many of us here in Quebec and by extension much of the world. So on Monday, La Presse broke a story that one of its very own journalists, Patrick Legasse, had been under police surveillance for many months. Since we've learned that this is kind of an epidemic, the police have been tracking a total of 6 other journalists as well. So even though a judge approved the warrants for the tracking, a chorus of people responded swiftly to denounce the spying. Journalists the Prime Minister of Quebec, and even the police union have decried it as a core threat to source protection and thus the journalistic enterprise, which is one of the vital pillars of democratic society. So looming over this news is a question. Was this a kind of one-time, very particular event, or a single and potent example of a far more systematic set of surveillance practices? Well, Edward Snowden's revelations brought to light how pervasive this is, not just in the United States, but the participation of the United States Five Eyes partners, including Canada. In so doing, Snowden ignited a long overdue debate about the state of surveillance, and he's already influenced important judicial decisions in the United States and in the UK. Just last week, British courts ruled that some of its government's bulk collection programs, which Snowden helped reveal, were in fact illegal for amassing information about its own citizens. Now, one of the most astounding and disturbing revelations in the Snowden documents concerned journalists. Some of these documents showed that the GCHQ, which is the British equivalent to the NSA, captured and retained emails written by journalists. Worse, GCHQ officials deemed investigative journalists as a threat similar to hackers and terrorists. So blatantly targeting journalists as the Montreal police did, or pegging them as an enemy of the state as GCHQ did, makes pervasive surveillance so alarming. Investigative journalists must be granted the protection of the state and the autonomy they need to accomplish their watchdog role. To accord privacy to journalists is necessary, but it is also not enough. Everyone, not just journalists, have the right to privacy, and citizens are, if not more vulnerable, at least as vulnerable to these forces. Digital communication is a critical component to participation in a free and democratic society. Advances in surveillance technology are rapidly eroding everyone's ability to participate safely, securely, and privately. These technologies are betraying your identity, your location, and your conversations. The process of criminalizing tools that enhance your privacy or mandating back doors has a chilling effect on everyone. More than anyone else, Edward Snowden and his willingness to come forward with very concrete details about surveillance has helped us grasp the bigger picture. He has helped us sharpen our understanding of the harms of pervasive surveillance and helped us see how new technologies facilitate ubiquitous spying. These issues are vitally important. And this is why I want you to join me not just in welcoming, but in thanking Edward Snowden for opening up the space to discuss and debate these topics.
Thank you. Thank you. If I could say a few words to begin. First off, thank you all for your patience tonight. I did not know what time this was going to begin either. It's about 3:15 a.m. in Moscow right now tonight. And I want to say one more thing briefly, which is I understand there was a strike. I was not told that there was a strike that was happening today. And this caused a lot of trouble for all of you who are in line. But I'd like to ask you not to hold that against the protesters, because there's something that we need to remember that I understand things got heated, you know, words were exchanged, and this is the kind of thing that happens in a democracy. We have uncertainties, we have difficulties, we have inconveniences, but these things are not a weakness, these things are a strength. And although, again, I understand that these individuals may have caused difficulty, it was for something that I think we can all agree they must have believed in very strongly, because it is very, very, very hard, and I know this better than most, to be the least popular person in the room, particularly when there are many more of the others than there are of you. So just because I can't take a position on their strike because I'm not familiar with the group, I didn't know anything about this, I will say one thing that we can do to help is just let everybody who's on the live stream hear what you in the audience have already, I think, had to confront, which is the name of this group. I think it's the Association of McGill University Support Employees. And I think they're trying to get a fair wage or something like that. I'd encourage any of you who are connected or impacted by these employees, their groups, or their efforts to please at least hear them out and go look at their materials. With that said, let's get into it. I'm not going to give you a whole preamble and go sort of through my background because I think, again, you guys have been waiting in line this long. We already know it. But one of the central questions is, you know, why did I come forward? Why does it matter? And how does this impact the way we're living now? And I think the central nexus that's affecting everybody the most right now, particularly in this current moment of news, is the fact that we're all being watched, right? Regardless of whether we're doing anything right or wrong. And this is a fundamental change, and this is what drove me forward. Traditionally, the work of intelligence services, the work of surveillance agencies, of police investigators, had always been particularly and specifically targeted towards individuals who we had probable cause that had been demonstrated to a court were up to no good. Foreign spies, you know, military units from adversarial nations. These were the guys that we were watching. But with the rise of the internet, right, advances in our science, our understanding of math, the way things are tied together, the communications network, and the way it has sort of swallowed the earth, radically changed the dynamic. Now, surveillance technologies have outpaced democratic controls. Those things that we used to enjoy a generation ago were primarily the product of one particular technological peculiarity, which is that surveillance was expensive, extremely so. Governments had to spend extraordinary sums to track individuals. To know someone's location might involve many teams of officers, both in buildings, behind desks, and those out on the street, working in shifts. I apologize. We've got somebody who just joined the stream. I'm not sure if the university added this, but it was causing a little echo. All right, we've got that fixed, I think. Basically this dynamic where you had to have whole groups of people tracking one individual. But now, thanks to this rise in technology, that has been reversed entirely. Now you can have one guy sitting somewhere completely far away from the target, like myself at the NSA in Hawaii, who can track with extreme precision an unimaginably large number of people. Rather than having whole teams following one person, now you have one person following whole groups, whole individuals, and they don't have to be connected in any way. And this means for the first time in human history, it's both technologically and financially feasible for governments to track and store nearly complete records of all of our lives. And this is not science fiction. This is happening now. This is not a black screen. This is the massive data repository. The NSA constructed this in Bluffdale, Arizona. It's since been renamed to the Mission Data Repository, because I think they presumed that Massive Data Repository probably wasn't the best branding anymore in the wake of the things we learned in 2013. But what does this represent? This represents that shift in dynamic. Now, we never knew what this facility was doing. We never knew why it was created. Governments have not asked for the permission of the public in order to engage in these kind of operations. Instead, it deployed these kind of capabilities in secret, even when they knew these programs were unlawful or unconstitutional, perhaps even because they knew this. And this effort has been enabled because of failures in our intended mechanisms for constitutional oversight of our sort of democratic societies. Courts, were unwilling to permit legal challenges against the activities of these spy agencies because they said they were speculation. They could say, well, you can't prove you were spied on because it's classified. You don't have access to documents or records. Therefore, we, the courts, even though this could be a violation of your rights or the rights of everyone in the country, don't have a place in this debate because first you have to establish the facts. We had a Congress in the United States that knowingly permitted national security officials to brazenly lie to the public without consequence or even correcting the record. This is a senator in the United States who is questioning the most senior intelligence official in the United States, General James Clapper, the director of national intelligence. And it is a felony to give false testimony when you are sworn under oath. But that is exactly what happened in 2013, 3 months before I came forward.
Does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir.
It does not.
Not wittingly. There are cases where they could inadvertently, perhaps, collect, but not wittingly.
Unfortunately, that was not true. And this brings us to consider sort of, where does this leave us? Because at the time that happened, the public had no idea it was a lie. The senator asking the question did know it was a lie. The director of national intelligence knew that it was a lie as well. Apologize, we've got someone else who's joined the stream. All right, hopefully the university can get that under control. But the thing here is all of the powerful people in the room knew this was a lie, but they didn't correct the record. They allowed the public to be deceived, even though it was, in fact, a crime. The director of national intelligence later admitted this was a false statement, saying it was what he considered the least untruthful thing he could say at the time, and too cute by half. But what does it mean in a democracy where the very foundation of the government, the legitimacy of our system, is derived from the idea that we, when we cast our votes, are providing consent for the government to carry out these policies? Consent, as hopefully everyone in this room can tell you, is only meaningful if it is informed. I get the feeling that we have a live stream somewhere that is displaying things that are allowing people to join. But I hope that all of you who are joining will at least mute your microphones. Thank you so much, those who did join. Let's see. Whoever is managing the AV, if you could hide that URL, that'd be helpful, although I think it's probably too late for tonight. So let's just try to push through. What this means, right, when the executive abuses secrecy so we don't know what's going on, when the Congress won't hold Miss, who just joined, if you could please mute your microphone as well, that would be really fabulous. Thanks. We don't need to hear your vacuum cleaner. What this means is we're forced to rely upon democracy's safeguard of last resort, right? That is the Fourth Estate, meaning our press, in alliance with whistleblowers who are more commonly known as journalistic sources. Now, unfortunately, we are today seeing the ability of journalists to operate free from interference come under threat, even in what are traditionally considered.
Sorry, folks. That's what happens when we send it live.
Now it works. Okay, so we were just having some trouble reestablishing contact, but now we're chatting. And so everyone got a lesson in internet trolling. And so hopefully in a couple more minutes, we'll get the video back up.
All right, let's wait for that call notification to drop. I apologize to everybody who is in that Google Hangout. If we could get the actual live stream set back up, that would be fabulous. And we can continue. And if I could ask the moderator as well.
Thank you. If I could ask the actual moderator, just to confirm, do we have the live stream up? Or are we ready to continue?
Yes, we're ready to go.
Okay. And could you tell me where you lost me?
You were talking about the branding. No. You did Clapper.
Okay. Well, look, guys, let's simplify this. Let's make this a little more casual, and hopefully we can regain a little bit more time from the university here, since I know you guys waited a long time for this tonight. And just make it a little bit more casual, because, again, nobody likes speeches, right? We're facing a big problem today, right? We have powerful political forces that are asking for more and more power, more and more authority. They say we're facing a time of extraordinary threat. There are now lone individuals, these kind of super criminals, right, like terrorists, spies, and things like that, who are totally capable of destabilizing our entire societies, ending our governments, collapsing our states. Now, there's no real evidence that that's actually the case, but the politics of this fear have really reshaped the way that our laws are being passed. So we have to figure out, how do we maintain a free society in the context of an unlimited government? This we've seen in Canada through bills such as C-51 and so on and so forth. The United States, of course, we had the birth of mass surveillance on a truly global scale. The UK is now passing what they call the Investigatory Powers Bill, which is really an unrestrained and unprecedented intrusion into the private lives of every citizen, not only in their country, but everywhere else. When the government is presuming a trust in the propriety of their actions that no longer exists. This story about the Montreal police spying on a journalist through their phone in a very intense way for the particular reason, a specified reason, of uncovering the sources behind their journalism is a radical attack on the operations of the free press. And speaking as one of the directors of the Freedom of the Press Foundation, this unsettles me not only on a personal level, but I think is something that actually represents a threat to the traditional model of our democracy. Can we recognize, or at least debate in a reasoned way, a new idea which is somewhat radical, which is that law is beginning to fail as a guarantor of our rights? It is the lowest bar protecting the way we operate, the interact with one another, because government has built in so many mechanisms to get around these things, these restrictions, when it wants to, that now the local police can decide that they don't like a journalist's reporting. They can go to a justice of the peace And the Justice of the Peace will quite happily say, okay, that sounds great. Look at the GPS on his phone. Figure out everywhere he's traveling. Figure out everyone he's communicating with. No, you can't actually read his emails. No, you can't actually listen to his calls. But you can find out everyone he met with, who he called, how long he was on the call with. And from this derive an extraordinary understanding of how this individual works. And it wasn't just one. It's now expanding. We're hearing six, maybe possibly more. And rather than the police chief saying, all right, this was clearly something that went too far, and regardless of whether or not I authorized this operation, I recognize that to restore trust, I need to reestablish the basis of accountability, that accountability that is lost when our operations become secret. And for that reason, I have chosen to resign. We don't see the mayor calling for that. We don't see the local premier calling for that. And it's this question, this dynamic, where our governments are increasingly invested with extraordinary capabilities to peer into all of our private lives with very little interference, whereas we, the public, can know almost nothing about how they operate. This inverts the traditional dynamic of private citizens and public officials into this brave new world we're facing of private officials and public citizens.
So thank you so much for that. And actually, I think this is really great because over the last couple of weeks, I was able to get a lot of really amazing questions. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to ask one or two questions, and then we'll also take questions from the audience. So I'm going to start with a question from Vincent Prager, who's a member of Media at McGill Board of Trustees. And he's quite interested in ethics and journalism. And so this is how the question is oriented. Given your status of a fugitive in the eyes of the United States government, what ethical considerations and or restrictions should guide the media in the United States and elsewhere around the world in reporting on you and your story? Are there different ethical guidelines from country to country? What is your level of satisfaction with such reporting on your story, and has it been equally fair from country to country? So it's a nice kind of comparative media question. So take it away.
So one of the things that I've tried to be very careful about since June of 2013, when I first came forward, was not telling the media how to do their job. I worked very hard to make sure that I wasn't in the decision loop, that I didn't say what was published or not. In fact, this is something that not everyone understands, but the number of documents that I published, that I made publicly available, has been zero. Instead, I gathered inside the NSA what I believe to be evidence of criminal activity within the government. And this wasn't just in the United States government. This was the Five Eyes Surveillance Alliance, right? This is a transnational spying group. Consisting of the United States, the United Kingdom, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. And this is, of course, why we have some understanding of what was actually going on behind the curtain in Canada about the operations of their sort of surveillance context. And that is, excuse me while I try to find the reference for this here, something that has actually been established in the wake of 2013 with more scrutiny, that Canada actually has the weakest intelligence oversight out of any major Western country. This was something that people didn't really expect. Now, they're not the most aggressive of all countries. They don't have the largest scale. But no one's really watching. There is no real parliamentary understanding of what's happening behind the door. And this is what allowed them to engage in massive sort of indiscriminate surveillance, dragnet surveillance that was affecting millions of Canadians, that was targeting, for example, the app stores that you might connect to with your phones, things that have now been published and we can now debate, but prior to these disclosures, we didn't really know, right? But here's the idea behind this comparative media question. This was my belief, that these things were violations of human rights, of written statutory laws, or our basic constitutional principles. But what if I was wrong? What if I was sort of this crazy radical and I had been in my head so long, you know, working in these intelligence places, talking to my coworkers, that I just didn't have a full understanding? Maybe I didn't see the big picture. If I published these things on my own, I believe there was a somewhat larger risk, a greater risk, that I would go too far. And so because of this, I chose instead to replicate the system of checks and balances in our government that had unfortunately failed over time, to try to restore that balance. And the way that I wanted to check myself was to instead provide this archive of documents to journalists, who would then be required, by virtue of gaining access to this archive, to make an independent judgment in every case for every story, not that it was newsy, not that it was interesting, not that it was just a sexy story, but it was actually in the public interest to know about the details of this operation or that operation, why it mattered, what was going on and how it was being accomplished, and what this meant for our rights. Now, beyond this, as an additional safeguard to mitigate risks, I wanted these journalists to then go to the governments who are actually carrying out these operations in each case to allow the government a chance to argue that they didn't understand these stories, that maybe they had gotten the calculus wrong. Maybe there was some detail, some sentence in the story that would actually put a human life at risk just because it was like the, you know, something that a journalist might not recognize, like the employee number of somebody that's a cafeteria worker overseas, but might actually be an intelligence source who could be recognized by these documents. And in every case, this was followed, right? The government didn't get a veto. They couldn't say you can't publish these stories, but they could say, look, this is dangerous or it's not. And this is why in 2016, I believe, the government has never been able to show a single case, credible or incredible, of any evidence that indicates anybody came to harm as a result of this reporting. Now, there's a second dynamic of this question, which is screw the NSA, screw the reporting, screw all the actual stuff that's going on about the surveillance operations, and what's going on with me? Are people being fair to me? Are they covering this way or that way? Are some countries doing better? Some countries doing worse? And of course, this is the case. We have seen in the majority of countries that are not the United States, they've done public polling opinion, and pretty much universally, people have a positive opinion of what I did. The United States government, of course, has been running a very active smear campaign to reduce the level of support for my arguments and for this journalism ever since 2013. And it has been, to some extent, effective, not fully, actually. There's a surprising amount of support. The three largest human rights groups in the world, the ACLU, or the three leading groups, the American Civil Liberties Union, Amnesty International, and Human Rights Watch, are now actually petitioning the President of the United States to drop what the media calls his war on whistleblowers. But here's the central idea there, from my perspective. Doesn't actually matter what people say about me. I am the least important part of this story. And if you're thinking about sort of me, what's happening to me, what my futures look like, you're missing the larger question, which is what happens to all of us.
Well, thank you for that very thoughtful question. What I'm going to do now is ask one more question, and then already people are lining up, or they're just sitting on the stairs. So line up if you have some questions. All right, so I'm really actually excited about this question. It's by one of my students, Aaron Gluck Thayer, who, like Snowden, is very much passionate about these issues. He's an engineering student here at McGill. And I'm just going to read it because he wrote it very carefully. He says, it's clear that intelligence agencies interpret their legal mandate expansively. Michael Hayden, the former director of the NSA, famously said, quote, give me the box you will allow me to operate in. I'm going to play to the very edges of that box. I will play very aggressively in it. Canada's Foreign Intelligence Agency, CSE, is similar. By exploiting the uncertainty in the legal definition of metadata, it can, quote, incidentally collect troves of personal data on Canadians. Canadian Domestic Intelligence Agency, CSIS, also operates under a similar culture. And he gives another example and then goes on to say, under Bill C-51, CSIS's expansive capabilities were broadened even further. The only limits to their new and vague disruption powers are that CSIS cannot willfully obstruct justice, cause bodily harm, or violate sexual integrity. I promise this is the only very detailed question like this. So there seems to be a culture in intelligence agencies of working the law to their purposes and pushing the law to its boundaries. Intelligence agencies don't ask what their surveillance practices should be. Rather, they ask what their surveillance practices are allowed to be. And then he says, this can create the appearance of lawfulness, which the government points to whenever the activities of intelligence agencies are challenged by the public. But all it does is subvert the law. So here's the question. How do we ensure that intelligence agencies interpret the law not just narrowly, but in a way that is reconcilable with what the public reasonably expects? When reforming our intelligence agencies, do we have to abandon the premise that intelligence agencies are committed to following the law in a reasonable way?
So this is a great question. It's a very complex question. One of the interesting things is the question quoted Michael Hayden, former director of both the NSA and the CIA, which is a little bit of a mistake because, of course, if you're the head of the CIA and the NSA, you are literally a professional liar. Deception is sort of your business. So he has a little bit of a checkered history because he says, give me the lines of the box and I'll play to the edge. I'll get chalk on my cleats, but I won't leave the field of play. Unfortunately, we have documentary proof that that's not the case. He was actually asked, as director of the NSA in the post-9/11 period, by the President of the United States through the Vice President's lawyer, would he basically violate the law? There was a controversy where the Attorney General of the United States said that the NSA's operations were unlawful. They could not be performed consistently with the authorities that were provided under the Constitution or statutes that had been passed authorizing their operations. And the president came to him through these proxies and said, would you go ahead and continue spying on everyone anyway, even if the Attorney General is against it? And he said, yes. And this is not, this is not to beat up him specifically because he's not so important. He's just one of a long line of officials that do the same thing. As you mentioned, happens across borders. It happens across cultures. It happens across languages. You're kidding yourself if you think intelligence officials in France, Germany, China, Russia, North Korea, Iran, Brazil, India, aren't doing the same thing. This is how they operate. So this means the central premise of that question, how do we trust and ensure that we can trust these intelligence agencies and officials to interpret the law fairly, to operate fairly? And the answer is you can't. But what you can do is put processes and instructions in place where you don't have to. And this leads us to kind of the failings of C-51 and the larger problem of Canada's intelligence apparatus, where there is no oversight that's meaningful. There are three main problems, fundamental problems with C-51, which the current Prime Minister of Canada, correct me if I'm wrong, did campaign to reform and unfortunately has not done so. Most experts who have studied this bill say it actually can't be reformed in a meaningful way. As written, it should be repealed entirely. And then a better measure passed from scratch that loses all the baggage. But first off, there's no meaningful oversight there, right? What would be meaningful oversight? How do you ensure that you don't have to trust these intelligence officers? And the way you do that is you appoint a judicial body, some mechanism, some structure, some commission that has independent prosecutorial authority that is mandated to perform a case-by-case review of these intelligence agencies, these police agencies, their use of powers, exceptional powers, after the fact of investigation to ensure that no illegalities occurred. And if they did occur, they can then prosecute on this basis. The only thing that will ensure that these intelligence agencies or police agencies or even corporations, as they gain access to these kind of mass surveillance capabilities, play fairly, is the threat of criminal sanction. Now, this means basically you don't get in the way of the intelligence services saying, look, you've got to go, you know, do all of these things before you investigate this person or that person, before you pull the email of someone that you suspect is a terrorist. But you must know that in every case, we're going to have a judge and a prosecutor going through your decisions after the fact. And if you did break the law, you will be held to the account of our laws in that case. The second thing is sharing without necessity, transparency, or accountability right. Canada's services can now make available all of the different information that they hold about you. And this can be things such as your health records, right? It doesn't have to actually be anything spooky. They can now be traded amongst agencies, even if you're not related to some real terroristic threat or anything like that. It's not very well limited. And then there's this larger question of the criminalization of speech, right? We already see that spying authorizations, legal authorizations, sorry, that weren't intended to be used for spying in this context or for surveilling people who are not terrorists, or real criminal threats, violent threats, threats to life, and so on and so forth, are instead being used, repurposed for monitoring terrorists and things like, or monitoring terrorists, forgive me, monitoring journalists who are not the same as terrorists, despite what the GCHQ says. Unless you work at an intelligence agency, in case you might be worried about them. But the idea here is, let's take that example of the Canadian journalists who have been spied on by the Montreal police. We have the news story saying that what happened, but we still don't actually know under what legal authority it occurred. There is a suspicion that this was actually done under Bill C-13, correct me if I'm wrong, fact check me, audience. That was actually intended to be passed as a cyberbullying law. That's how it was branded. Was that actually being used to collect the communication of journalists? Was C-51 involved? Were any of these other legal authorities involved? We don't know, because we have no idea what the government is actually doing underneath that curtain. And that is not just a risk. That is a fundamental danger to the stability of any open and liberal society. Suddenly, we have a set of rules for all of you in the audience. There's a set of rules that can get whistleblowers and journalists charged and investigated by police. But what about when police break the law? What about when spies break the law? Suddenly, they're being held to a very different legal standard, and they're entitled to a veil of secrecy that inoculates them against criticism and scrutiny that the rest of us do not enjoy. That is an imbalance of power that is not only, I would say, unwise, but is actually anti-democratic. It is authoritarian in nature.
So go ahead and try, unlike what I just did, keep the question a bit short so we can get to others.
Okay. Can you hear me? No?
No?
Okay.
forgive me, to be clear, I am not getting that audio at all, so if I could ask Gabrielle if you could repeat that for me.
Now, can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Okay. Perfect. Awesome. So my question is that knowing that most of those surveillance decisions are made on a political level, do you have any comments on the current presidential elections in the United States?
So this is a complicated question for me because everybody's like, you know, who should I vote for? Who should I vote for? What do you think? And the reality here is there are two reasons that I never answer this question. One is if you have to ask other people, you're not really appreciating the burden and the value of your opinion, your perspective in the operation of our democracy. Don't look to others to tell you who to vote for. Look to you. Read about these things. Listen to the conversation. Make a determination for yourself. The second thing here is, as a privacy advocate, the decision of who you vote for, right, is something you should never be made to answer. And so I try to set a good example there in not responding. What I will say is that I think it's very disappointing in the long history of American democracy, where we are, if nothing else, a very successful country, that we are going through an entire election cycle where all we hear about are the personalities of these candidates, the insults that they throw each other. But we hear very little about the Constitution. And this reminds me of a mistake that I made during the last sort of change of power in the United States, from the Bush administration to the Obama administration. He was a president who campaigned on the idea of ending the worst excesses of the Bush administration. He promised to hold officials who had broken the law, who had engaged in torture and so on and so forth, to account, to do investigations, to hold trials. But as soon as he took office, he abandoned that promise, saying we need to look forward, not backwards. But every investigation is necessarily retrospective looking. And if you say that there can never be a look backwards at official crimes, what you're saying is that there can be no accountability for official crimes. He said he would end warrantless wiretapping. We weren't going to do that anymore. And in fact, he expanded it and institutionalized it in many ways. These are disappointing things. But when he came to take office, because he claimed these things, I believed that they would happen. I took him at his word. And many others did, you know. This is not to say it's a terrible thing to have faith in officials and belief in the power of hope. But I think we all need to recognize that we should be extraordinarily cautious about putting all of our hopes on political candidates, on elected officials. Because if we look at history, their promises very rarely equate to their products. And while you may appreciate one candidate above the other, the ultimate answer to democracy here is that we cannot rely on others to do the things that we must do for ourselves. And ultimately, if you want to build a better country, you're going to have to do it yourself.
So we're going to take a question on this side. I'm going to pose one more question, and then we'll go to you.
Hello. Hi. Do you hear me?
Hi. I can. Thank you.
Okay. My question is, are there any circumstances under which it is fair for a country to engage in mass surveillance of its people?
I think this would be an argument of utilitarianism, right? Do the ends justify the means as long as they're beneficial? This ultimately gets to the question of efficacy. So we have a lot of evidence that mass surveillance is actually not very effective. In the United States, for example, in the wake of 2013, we had two independent presidential commissions appointed to investigate the claims that have been made by journalists. These are staffed with White House allies, right? Not radical hippie reformists or anything like that. They included officials such as the former deputy director of the CIA. So not exactly what you would consider to be friends of civil liberties. And yet, despite having full access to classified information, being able to walk into the FBI, the NSA, the Defense Intelligence Agency, and all of these other areas that are involved in the spying, and saying, tell us what's going on, and having clearances to actually see it, they could not identify a single instance in which the kind of mass surveillance represented by the warrantless wiretapping, the telephony metadata program happening in the US, basically collecting the call records of everybody in the way that the Montreal police were using against this journalist, but on a much broader scale, had never actually resulted in a positive benefit. It had never made a concrete difference in the outcome of any terrorism investigation. Moreover, it had never even contributed to the discovery of an unknown plot. But what if it had? This is very similar to arguing, what if torture were effective? What if extrajudicial murder were effective, right? We're talking about assassinations here. What if slavery were a wonderful economic program? It wouldn't make it right. We have human rights for a reason, right? And we protect these things. And these are policies that are promoted by these same governments. The United States, of course, put forth the Universal Declaration of Human Rights with the UN, which guarantees a right from the arbitrary interference in your private communications, right? It forbids mass surveillance. So I would argue it's not a question of can this thing be justified in terms of efficacy or whatever. It's do we want to live in a world without human rights?
So I'm going to switch the gears a little bit and ask a question from a PhD student, Isadora Borges Monroy, who's in my class on computer hackers. And we actually all went to see the Snowden film this fall, and most of us have also seen Citizen Four. And Snowden, I think you're absolutely right that the important issues are the issues and not the person, but the person has become fodder for Hollywood. And Oliver Stone did present the issues in some very interesting ways, and this is a great way to reach different publics. And so she had a question which I've actually thought quite a bit about, because in the movie, a bunch of the other techies working at the NSA had reservations like you. So she's asking whether, you know, this is actually accurate. And it is striking that while in some ways you are the most famous whistleblower, there have been others such as William Binney and Thomas Drake who have sounded the whistle. So we'd just like to hear a little bit more about the kind of work culture at the NSA or the contracting corporations, and how people kind of express their dissatisfaction, or whether you kind of thought of the problems in a kind of siloed way and then just acted independently.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I brought my concerns to a lot of my different colleagues. I brought them to supervisors. I showed them specifically this slide amongst others. It was actually not a slide at the time. It was, okay, it's not actually displaying because it looks like my system has run out of memory to display that. But it's a global heat map of the NSA's surveillance, right? This was an interactive tool inside the agency that said where we are collecting the most communications, right? Where we're ingesting the most emails, the most phone calls into our systems, right? Text messages, your internet traffic, Google searches, things like that. And it showed that we were actually collecting more American communications than we were Russian communications. And I asked them, you know, is this what we signed up for? Is this what we were trying to achieve? And of course they said, no, you know, that doesn't seem right. That's not really accurate. But they said, hey, look, you know what happens to people who rock the boat. And they specifically referenced people like Thomas Drake, of course, who was a very famous case in this example. But the idea here is that, yes, every whistleblower learns from the individuals who came before. I would not have been possible without the examples of Daniel Ellsberg, of William Binney, of Thomas Drake, of Chelsea Manning. Because it is this iterative understanding of our history, how the government operates, how they are likely to respond, how you interact successfully with journalists and unsuccessfully, that informs your thinking, your method of operation, and your belief that change can be achieved. And I'm so thankful for these people who came before, because they showed that, yes, the NSA will retaliate. The United States government will retaliate, regardless of whether it's right or wrong, regardless of whether they have any grounds or belief. I knew I would be charged with the Espionage Act, despite the fact that I was not a spy. I wasn't contacting foreign governments. I was contacting journalists, because this is what they did to Thomas Drake, who did the same thing the government. This was a senior NSA executive, for those who are not familiar, at the very top levels of the agency in the wake of 9/11, who discovered the warrantless wiretapping program and a privacy-preserving equivalent program that the NSA killed. And because they suspected him of telling the media about these programs, even though he went through proper channels, he went to the inspector generals, he went to his supervisors, he went to the lawyers to ask them sort of what was going on. They destroyed him in retaliation. They didn't go, look, he went through the process, he did the right thing, he went to Congress to tell them about what was going on. They said, let's indict him as a spy under the Espionage Act. So he is prohibited from telling the jury why he did what he did. The Espionage Act is one of the few laws in the United States that guarantees you cannot receive a fair trial, and it's designed that way intentionally. That's kind of a feature, not a bug. And if I had not seen that, I may have made less wise decisions.
So thank you for that answer.
If I may, I can ask the technical staff, I'm going to reconnect this because it looks like you've lost a video real quick. I'll be back in about 30 seconds.
Great. Okay.
Thank you again so much.
Looks
for,
like you're back.
The technical challenges we have.
Hello. Yes.
Just to confirm,
Hi, Edward.
Can we get that mic on?
Hello. Can you hear me?
I can now. Thank you.
Okay. So my name is Cesar Rezer. I'm actually from Brazil. I'm living here in Canada for 6 years, and I have a curious question for you. In the facts revealed back in 2013 by Glenn Greenwald, who is currently living in Brazil, Brazil was one of the countries and governments that was being spied by NSA. Recently, in Brazil, a massive corruption scandal involving the petroleum company led to a massive protest and the impeachment of the president Dilma Rousseff without being yet directly involved in this scandal. Do you believe that the USA uses this technology to drive minor democracies and people who vote to empower governors that will benefit them?
So this is a foreign policy question, right? More so than an intelligence question. But it does have a nexus. It does connect. But the answer here is, when we think about that example we just saw, right, where all of these independent commissions looked at these mass surveillance programs and they found that they had no benefit for counterterrorism, you have to think, the NSA has a lot of really smart people working there. They have a lot of very sophisticated top-level officials and low-level employees, the line workers. So why are they running this program if it doesn't benefit counterterrorism operations? And of course, the logical presumption would be, well, it must have benefit somewhere else. And this is the real story of mass surveillance. Mass surveillance has never been established as effective for counterterrorism, right? These laws are always passed saying they'll be used against terrorists. But the reality is they're used for other things. These programs were never about terrorism. They're about power. And when you think about these capabilities, when you think about all the things that they're doing, when you think about what these intelligence agencies do all day, there aren't that many terrorists who are meaningful, who represent a real threat. And they have all of these specialists who work in other areas. What do you think these folks are doing all day? Why do you think these intelligence agencies exist if not to apply these capabilities for what these officials consider to be the national interest?
Thank you very much.
So we have time for two more questions, and what I'm going to do is have the gentleman here on the right ask a question. And I was going to say we'll have one of the women come forward, which we had to do that with a Glenn Greenwald talk as well. So why don't we start with you, the woman in the gray. Yeah, come on forward.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can.
First of all, thank you so much for staying up and taking the time to talk to us. Sorry.
It's my pleasure. You guys have been waiting a long time.
My question is mostly because most of the people that are in the room and in the line and watching from the live stream are students here in Montreal. And my question is basically what your vision is in terms of us moving forward and protecting civil liberties and our freedoms and democracies. And then what are the tangible things that youth today can do to minimize the risks, especially because we're the generation that's most connected and that clicks, I agree to the terms and conditions faster than. Yeah, anyway, that's my question.
Yeah, you know, the main thing is that you guys are already doing what so many people have not in a visible way, right? You saw that line outside to talk about surveillance. The first thing, and I think one of the most central things you can do, is all of these politicians like to create an appearance that no one cares about privacy, that no one cares that they're being watched. But we know this is not the case. You all are here establishing that this is not the case. So the very first thing that you should do is argue whenever anybody brings that stuff forward, whenever anybody comes up with that argument saying, you know, I don't care because I've got nothing to hide, go wait. Privacy isn't about something to hide. Privacy is about something to protect. It's about protecting your rights. It's about protecting your sense of self. It's about protecting an open and liberal society, a free society where you can be who you want, where you can think what you want, where you can have a private conversation between friends, between confidants, where you can figure out what it is that you actually believe in. Privacy is the fountainhead of all other rights. It is the basis from which the other rights derive their meaning, their value. Freedom of speech doesn't mean very much if you can't figure out what it is that you actually want to say and instead have to repeat what other people say, what's popular, because that's the only thing that's safe to say. Right? If you can immediately be separated and prejudged because you are different, right? That's what privacy is about. Privacy is the right to the self. Privacy is the right to be you. And this is, you know, coded all the way in our language when you go down to, you know, private property, right? This is not popular with, you know, in very far to the left. But the idea here is that privacy is the ability to have something for yourself, whether it's a home, whether it's a car, whether it's a pencil, whether it is an idea, whether it is a belief, right? So when somebody says, I don't care about privacy because I've got nothing to hide. That's like saying that I don't care about free speech because I have nothing to say. It's not about you. It's about everyone. It's about all of us. It's about potential. It's about possibility. It's about the foundation of everything that we believe in, that so many people have fought and died for. And if you're not willing to stand up for your own right to be you, why do you care about what happens? All you're saying is that I'm willing to let everyone else decide everything that affects my life. I'm willing to let other people decide my future because I don't have any ideas of my own.
Great question, great answer, and we'll turn it over for one last question.
Hi, Edward. My name is Tristano. This question sort of follows from the last one. You said earlier that surveillance technologies have outpaced democratic controls. What tools do you think we can build to either improve these democratic controls or more specifically, tools to empower people in the face of government's lack of transparency, like software or otherwise?
So this is a great question. We could talk about this for hours. Unfortunately, we don't have it. So I'll try to make it quick. Let's take a little trip down recent memory to see if we can contextualize this for people who aren't so familiar. Wake of 2013, the President of the United States trying to push back against the belief and public presentation that the NSA was conducting mass surveillance, tried to contextualize things by saying, well, we're not actually reading everybody's emails. We're not actually listening to everybody's phone calls. We're just collecting them in case they're interesting later. We're just putting them in a bucket. We're just rifling through them. We're not actually scanning them. You know, we just want the safety measure. We don't want to miss anything. He's also talking about the distinction between metadata versus content. Metadata, for those who aren't familiar with it, the content of communications is what you're actually saying on the phone call, what you're actually writing in the body of the email, what you actually write inside the Facebook message. Metadata is one step out from that, and it has no meaningful legal protections in our current Western jurisprudence, which is the real danger, because the government holds that you don't actually own records of your activities, right? You only have a privacy interest in actually what you say, but not anything that anybody records about when you said it, how you said it, how long it took you to say it, things like that. So when we talk about that old school surveillance, right, that used to be targeted, you'd send a private eye to follow people around. And they would see these people leave their homes in the morning. They would write down what time of day they got up, where they left, the means of conveyance. They went in this car, it had this license plate number. This is metadata. No legal protections for it. You'd go to the cafe, you'd meet with someone. They couldn't sit so close to you that they heard everything you said, because you'd go, who is this weirdo following me around? But they'd sit near enough to see who you met with, how long you were there, you know, and be able to sort of assess the context of that relationship. Is this someone that he meets with all the time? Is this a lover? Is this a spouse? You can tell by the frequency of contact. You can tell by, do they spend the night with each other all the time, and these things like that. Now they're doing that instantly for everyone always because it's cheap, it's easy, it's free. By following your cell phones, right? Where does your cell phone go at night? What other cell phones are around that cell phone? The laptop that you're using, right? What networks does it connect to? Every network adapter, right? Whether it's the Wi-Fi card, whether it's the Ethernet port, whether it's the radio in your phone, has what's called a UUID or a GUID, universally unique identifier or globally unique identifier, right? These, you can think of them as little tags that are burned into the hardware of the device. They can't be changed on a permanent basis, at least without serious expertise. And this means that every time you connect to one of these networks, your device is different from every other device in the world that could be connected to it. There are meaningful technical reasons for this to happen, right? This wasn't a surveillance scheme, but a byproduct of this is that suddenly the devices that were designed to empower you can now be used to disempower you. They can be used to make you vulnerable. They can be used to watch you. And that is what's happening. Metadata in bulk, this collection that's happening with everyone, and no court needs to be involved, because again, they say you don't own these records. Facebook owns these records. The cell phone company owns this record of where your cell phone went, not you, right? So they can do whatever they want with it. They can hand it to the government voluntarily. They can provide it in response to a subpoena or a court order, which is not so objectionable, right? Companies can turn over things if the court says we have probable cause to believe this person's a criminal. But what if they do it for everyone all the time, everywhere? What if the government cuts out the middleman and starts doing it themselves by tapping the cross-border fiber optic communications that connect, for example, Canada to the United States or other countries? Well, the problem is the internet doesn't live in Canada, right? The internet lives all over the world. So the minute your communications go to Facebook or Google or Yahoo or anything like this, any major service that anybody's using, you know, you go to iTunes, that's creating a record that these people now didn't have to go to court to have on you. Now, so again, we've started to deviate, but again, it's a complex question. I apologize for taking so long. So Obama's going, well, we're not reading the content. And that's because he didn't want to have that conversation where he goes, but we are tracking basically everything else. When you have enough metadata, you don't need the content. Metadata is a proxy for content because machines can analyze it in a way that content can't. Metadata creates perfect records of private lives. Now, even if you believed him, turned out that was not true. He said, we're not rifling through people's emails, but we found out just last month that in fact, Yahoo, one of the major internet companies, had decided beyond what the law required, that they would scan all of their customers' emails on behalf of US intelligence. Now, they could have contested this in court, but they chose not to because they thought it would be secret and that nobody would find out. This is a danger of having companies that store enormous amounts of data on their customers. If you build it, they will come. Now, let's contrast that to a messenger, an app, right, for your smartphone called Signal. It's on iOS, it's on Android. It allows you to make encrypted calls, send encrypted texts to avoid this kind of thing, right? If you want to send photos to somebody and you don't want the Canadian government or anybody else to see it, even just your internet service provider, you've got to encrypt it. Well, the FBI came after them saying, we want to know what one of your users is doing. Signal went instead to a civil liberties organization, the ACLU, and they fought in court what they could. They found out that they couldn't resist the order, which is okay, you know, they've got no legal recourse there. But they said, what if we fight the secrecy order? What if we fight for the right to tell people that it happened? And there they won. And here's where it gets interesting. They did cooperate with the FBI. They had to, they had no legal choice. But because of the design of their service, this is the actual records, all of the records that they handed over to the FBI. The government redacted it, but we know based on the operation what it was. The account number on the left is the phone number that the government already had because the government said, you know, we want you to look up this number. And the only information that this company held was when the account was created, the date, and the last time that it connected, because they weren't tracking who you were calling with this. They weren't tracking what you were doing with this because it wasn't necessary for the operations of their business. This gives us an idea, a framework of a safer world, particularly for journalists and individuals who have a real need, right? Not just a rights-based need, but a professional need, perhaps a safety-based need. Because if you're a journalist in Beijing or Moscow or somewhere else, and the government can see who you're contacting, that could actually get people jailed, killed, or worse. We need to move to a paradigm where all of our communications are encrypted by default. Now, what does encryption mean? For those who don't understand that mass surveillance problem with the metadata that we talked about earlier, the problem is when you think about the internet, how it actually works, how it fits together, when you send a text message, when you send a Facebook message, how does that actually get from your phone to the other person's phone, right? Well, it's got to travel over this no man's land of the internet. All of these systems that are physically connected, right? The fiber optic cables, the satellite links, all the radio hops, the microwave connections. You don't see any of this. It just happens, right? But it's there. And all of those people in the middle have a chance to look at that communication. If it's an SMS, right, a normal text message that you send, it's completely unencrypted. Anybody in the middle can read what it is, they can store what it is, they can save what it is. The same thing for normal emails that are sent unencrypted. Web traffic that's not HTTPS at the front of the bar, right, that's just HTTP, that's unencrypted, so anybody can see that. But if you encrypt it now, suddenly all they have is the metadata. They can't actually read that interior transmission. What this means is that governments have been exploiting this property to collect all of that stuff for free as your communications cross the internet electronically naked. Encryption allows us to armor our communications to walk through that dangerous valley and get to the other side with some dignity left intact. That's the first thing that we need to establish to protect the content of our communications. The second thing, which is a much more difficult problem, and maybe because you're students, you can research this problem and find a way to fix it permanently, is how do we protect the fact that the communication occurred at all in the first place, the metadata, right? There's what you said, and then there's also the fact that you said something at all. Can we protect the fact that you called your mother, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your professor, whatever? You called a hospital, you called an abortion clinic, you called a political group, you called a church. Any connection, where you spend your money, how you do it, where you travel, when you cross a border. Right now, we are living lives of unparalleled vulnerability to power. We live in a very safe time. Let's make no mistake about that, right? Everybody plays up the threat of terrorism. But if you look at any metric of mortality, if you look at any metric of quality of life, we're doing pretty good relative to historic circumstances. Yet at the same time, our ability to resist powerful institutions, be they corporate, be they governmental, has never been less than it is today. Because their powers throughout history have been very closely connected to ours, right? When people only had muskets, the government had to be pretty careful. When people only had horses, there was only so much they could do. When you have one side that has the largest surveillance machine that has ever been completed on a global basis in the history of humanity, and they have the exclusive use of it, and we, on the other hand, have smartphones that are saying everywhere we go all the time, every purchase we make, every website we visit, we need to think about what that means. It means we are creating permanent records of our daily activities that could be used for purposes that we will never know and have no say in. We have an obligation and we have a right to change the game and say, yes, if governments, if courts want to monitor criminals, they can do so. They can go to a judge. They can say, this is the evidence that we need to monitor this individual. But the days where they could monitor everyone, everywhere, all the time, simply what the government calls by means of bulk collection, which is the government euphemism for mass surveillance. They say, we just want to collect everything and store it in case we want to search it later. Those days are numbered. We are going to move towards a freer and fairer future rather than simply the one that has already been laid out for us. We are at a decision point, and we could have a very dark future or a very bright future, but the ultimate determination of which fork in the road we take won't be my decision, it won't be the government's decision, it will be your generation's decision. And I'm looking forward to seeing what it is that you guys actually decide.
So this is a perfect note and place to end from dystopian realism of the present to possible utopia of the future. And what I'd like to do is actually first thank the Beaverbrook Foundation for making this possible. And I'd also like to thank Snowden and the audience. And everyone is standing up right now.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your patience tonight. I know we had some difficulties, both in getting everybody in the room, getting the technology working. But this is an example of how, you know, if we have a little bit of patience, if we deal with a little bit of inconvenience, we can make things happen. And so thank you so much. And I hope that next year, I'll be able to see you in person.
Thank you. Thanks, Ed.